I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Patricia Power's eerie saga of a neighborhood besieged. Face of the foe. Starring Jessica Walter, Joseph Campanella, and Judy Kern. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Big Red Chewing Tobacco, V8 Vegetable Juice, and State Farm Insurance. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Winter in Montreal. Cold, blustery. A good time to stay indoors around a warm fire. Especially if you're a young woman like Nicole Nugent and living with a female friend like Laura Prescott. Staying indoors is an especially good idea if two women living just down the street have been murdered within the past week, which they have. Some male companionship, a shoulder to lean on, would perhaps be a comfort. Nicole has Christopher Galloway, but he's off working on a novel. And Laura has just returned home, accompanied by a gentle-mannered young Englishman named Julian Brooke. A comfort? Hardly. For Laura Prescott met the man while on her way home, while another man, whose face she couldn't see, was about to drag her off into the park. Face of the Foe continues after this message.
My body ached, my head was throbbing. And then Laura was there, back from her night class, white as a sheet. I got sick all over again.
A man attacked her on the street and tried to drag her off into the park.
Oh, Laura, how dreadful. Are you all right?
Yes, I'm all right. Thanks to Mr. Brooke. You tell her about it, will you, Julian?
After I pour you some brandy.
Thanks, Nicky. I'm just a bit shaky, that's all.
Mr. Brooke?
Yes, I could do this by myself, thank you.
Now, tell me.
Well, I was driving on Cote Saint-Luc, there along the park, you know, between Godfrey and Winnicott Road, when suddenly I saw this woman on the sidewalk struggling with a man. I braked my car quickly and dashed out to help her.
It was a risky thing to do, but thank God you did.
By then, the blackguard was trying to drag her off into the park. I shouted a warning, and he let go of her and ran off. Left poor Laura here shaking and sobbing on the grass.
Did he hurt you, Laura?
No, he just handled me roughly, that's all.
She'll have a few bruises, I should imagine.
But Lord knows what he would have done if Julian hadn't stopped to help me. It was foolish of me to be walking by it, especially after two women have just been murdered in this area.
And considering the man who accosted you might possibly have been the murderer, I think we'd better call the police.
I was expecting the battered little figure of Lieutenant Detective Philippe to reappear at our door in answer to Julian's call. But instead, a pair of lesser police officers arrived to take notes on the incident and firmly caution Laura and me to do no more walking the streets alone at night. Later in the week, I was especially glad that Julian Brooke had come into Laura's life because Norman Roxburgh, the obnoxious man in her restaurant administration class, was still giving her trouble.
He even grabbed my arm and tried to keep me from getting into the taxi last night after class. I can't reason with him, Nicky. He really hurt me. As if I didn't have enough black and blue marks from that awful little encounter in the park.
That is awful, but what can you do about him?
I've already done the only thing I can. Switch classes. They're on the same nights, but begin and end an hour earlier. so hopefully I won't have to see anything more of Mr. Roxburgh.
But a lot more of Julian Brooke? Laura only smiled, but the look in her sea-green eyes answered my question. It was Friday evening, and we were both dressing for our dates, hers with Julian, mine with Chris and Lisa and Guy Sagarin. And Emily was also coming by to pick up the birthday cake she'd asked Laura to bake.
Do you think your Aunt Emily's friend will like it?
Oh, he should love it. According to Aunt Emily, Donald Hamill is a nice boy with a lot of soul.
Leave it to your Aunt Emily to take in a couple of homeless boys up the street.
That worries me, especially from the way she describes the other one. She thinks he may be using drugs.
That could be risky.
You know, Aunt Emily, we should all live life to the fullest while we... That's probably her now. I'll get it. But it was Julian Brooke, looking youthful and attractive, in a narrow-cut royal blue coat that set off his fair skin and dark blonde hair. I ushered him into the living room and told him Laura would be out in a few moments. He settled on the sofa with a cocktail, and as I left the room, I saw him bring out a pad of paper and a pen and start sketching. Laura had told me he was a designer of modern furniture. This time it was Aunt Emily, in a pair of plum velvet knickers, white silk knee socks, and a white silk blouse with ruffles of lace at her throat and wrists. She looked like a transplanted court page. And to my surprise, she had her two homeless boys in tow.
Boys? This is my niece, Nicole. Nicky, this is Donald Hamill and Tony Bartha.
She sat down cross-legged on the floor, as she always did, and Donald settled beside her, cradling his guitar in his lap and stroking it fondly as though it were a baby. Tony Bartha, meanwhile, stayed scowling in a corner apart from the group. Aunt Emily's sparrow-bright eyes darted at once to the sketch Julian Brooke had been doodling. It wasn't furniture design after all, but a skillful line drawing in red ink of a sailing ship, its clouds of canvas billowing in imaginary wind, the figure of an angel blowing a trumpet at its bow.
That's a really far-out sketch, Mr. Brooke. Is she a clipper ship?
She's the flying cloud, a beauty. You a sailing enthusiast, Mrs. Teasdale?
Oh, yes. I love beauty in motion. You know, it's funny. I could swear I saw a very similar sketch of a clipper ship recently. Only where?
Do you ever pop into the Warwick Tea Room by any chance?
Of course, that's it. I go there sometimes after church for Sunday brunch. They have a whole wall of clipper ships, all done in red ink, as it happens.
Precisely. They're all there, the Cuttysark, the Mopolet, the Flying Spur, Sir Lancelot, Ariel.
Oh, ships have such romantic-sounding names. I must think of a magic, exciting name for my motorcycle. What do you think, Nicky?
I'm sorry, Aunt Emily. I'm only glad it's winter and you're not riding that thing.
Lovely girl, my niece, but so conservative. Aha! Let's hope this is that man of yours. I'll bet you he could think of a name.
It was Chris with Guy and Lisa. They made a striking-looking couple. Lisa was a statuesque blonde with a Valkyrian profile, her thick golden hair braided into a coronet, adding a queenly touch to her Earth Mother figure. Guy Sabrin was lean and suave-looking, his dark satyr face set off by a pair of bushy brows that curled upward like the horns of a devil, and a carefully groomed black Van Dyke beard.
A devil's beard!
What, Aunt Emily?
That detective investigating Kathleen Windsor's murder. He's been asking me to describe the man I saw her with in the car that day, and I couldn't for the life of me remember what he looked like. But seeing Mr. Sabarin reminded me.
He had a Van Dyke beard like mine?
Yes, Mr. Sabarin. The man had a beard like yours. Exactly like yours.
With the apartment full of people and the whole neighborhood nervous about the recent murders, leave it to Aunt Emily to say the wrong thing at the wrong time.
You have a devil's beard, Mr. Sabarin.
Please, Mrs. Teasdale, it's a Van Dyke or a space beard if you like, but don't call it a devil's beard. You'll frighten my wife.
She's perfectly right, darling. You do have a decidedly satanic look.
I have some very special good news to relate later tonight, haven't I, Lisa?
Oh, what is it? Can't you tell us now?
No, I've bought a special bottle of champagne to open with supper after the theater. My news will have to keep until then.
Chris and I exchanged a look. It was going to be a typical Guy Sabourin evening. His tickets to a play written by his friend, followed by his big news over a bottle of his champagne. He had to be the big shot. The last big news he'd had to share with us was the announcement of his promotion to senior salesman with the distillery firm he worked for. He had bought Lisa a mink coat to celebrate. That was Guy Sabourin's one redeeming quality in my eyes, his almost slavish devotion to Lisa.
Well, your celebration may keep, but Donald's won't. Some of the boys and girls from the drop-in center are coming to share that beautiful cake you made, Laura. Have you thanked Miss Prescott, Donald? Donald?
Oh, please, Aunt Emily. He doesn't have to. I was happy to do it.
Donald is painfully shy, I'm afraid. But not when it comes to his music. Why don't you thank everybody with a song, Donald? That lovely one you wrote. It always makes me cry. It's called City of Night. Go ahead, Donald.
Asphalt and concrete, neon and steel. Nowhere, nowhere, anything real. Bolted doors on the houses. Shutter doors on the hearts. Broken dreams in the concrete. Murder dreams in the steel. Grief in the darkness, grief and despair. Nowhere, nowhere, someone to care. Got to get out of this city of night. Find me, oh find me, my city of light.
No one spoke for a moment. Aunt Emily was wiping the tears from her eyes, and I felt a lump in my throat. I'd found myself thinking about poor Kathleen Windsor alone in her apartment, the lonely, love-starved prey of a depraved killer. Then I looked at Donald and saw his sensitive mouth begin to tremble and moisture brimming in his own eyes.
Donald's not used to people being good to him.
My thoughtful Chris moved over to talk to the boy, while Laura put the cake in a hat box for Aunt Emily to carry home. It seemed Aunt Emily was right about Donald Hamill. He was a nice boy with a lot of soul. She was equally right about Tony Bartha, who had done nothing but stand in the corner and look sullen the whole time. I didn't care much for his attitude either. The so-called comedy by Guy Sabourin's friend turned out to be a dismal tragedy. But Lisa's buffet dinner was more than making up for it.
If there was any humor in that comedy, I'm afraid it was too sick to live.
Of course, the rising young novelist Christopher Galloway is a far better judge than an unpublished amateur playwright like myself.
Well, I've never written anything more than an occasional postcard. But I judged the play tonight to be an unqualified bomb.
I guess you're right. My old buddy missed the mark with that one.
Darling, why don't you bring out your champagne now?
Right. We've been waiting all evening for this big news of yours, Guy.
It's worth waiting for, I promise you. Here we go. Very special champagne for a very special occasion.
Look at those beautiful bubbles.
And I'm ready to toast, if you'll just tell us what we're toasting.
A toast to my beautiful wife, Lisa, who is soon to make me a father.
Oh, Lisa, that's wonderful.
Congratulations, Guy. Now that is big news.
Ah, that isn't all. I have a little something else that's a surprise to Lisa as well. A small present, my love, in honor of the occasion.
Guy, what is it?
Open it and see.
Emeralds. But how...
I have a bit of news all my own, darling. I was just given a bonus as the firm's top salesman.
Guy, that's marvelous.
Yeah, nice going, Guy.
But I noticed Lisa didn't say a word. She stared at the emerald necklace for a long moment, then quietly snapped the case shut and put it away. While Chris humored Guy, I followed Lisa into the bedroom.
Ah!
Lisa, you're worried about something. It's not the baby, is it?
Oh, no, no. The baby's the most beautiful thing that's happened.
Then what is it?
It's Guy. He worries me. A mink coat, an emerald necklace. We can't afford such things.
But Guy explained. First his promotion, and now a bonus.
He's making all that up. I know he is. He didn't get promoted. And there hasn't been any bonus. That's what worries me so, Nikki. Where is Guy getting so much money?
It was Aunt Emily calling to tell Laura how much everybody had enjoyed her Schwarzwalder Kirschtorte. Donald had had a successful party with the kids from the drop-in center. He had played his guitar and they had all wrapped around the clock, as Aunt Emily put it. But then she got on the subject of Tony Bartha.
I've seen him hanging around Crestview Public School several times lately.
Why would someone his age want to hang around an elementary school?
My point exactly. And the other day I saw him talking to a man in a big flashy car parked at the corner by the school. When he saw me, they stopped talking and the man quickly drove away.
Did you ask Tony about it?
Yes. He said the man had just been asking for some directions. But I don't think I can take Tony at his word.
Aunt Emily, do you think there might be a connection between Tony's taking drugs and... Well, could he be selling them to school children?
That very thought occurred to me. He's no good, I'm afraid. Certainly he's no good for Donald.
Then you shouldn't be letting him stay at your house.
I've decided I'm not going to any longer. I'm telling him tonight that he has to leave by Monday. He can sleep at the center until he finds someplace else to go.
I hope he doesn't give you any problem about leaving. He's such a surly character.
Oh, he'll give me some of his lip, I suppose. But don't worry, I'll just tune him out. Bye, dear.
By the time Sunday afternoon rolled around, Laura was out on still another date with Julian Brooke. And after slaving all weekend over a hot bobbin, I was eagerly looking forward to my promised afternoon and evening with Chris. We were going to go antique shop browsing in Old Montreal, then have dinner.
I'm sorry to disappoint you, Nikki, but I have to write this afternoon. You go ahead and I'll meet you wherever you say for dinner.
But, Chris, you promised.
I know I did, Muffet, but I didn't get my quota of pages done this morning, so I'll just have to keep at it.
But it's only a matter of a few hours.
A few hours counts a lot when you're on a deadline. Now, you know how it is when I'm in the middle of a book.
I know that the book always seems to be more important than anything else.
That's not true, Nicole, but it is my work, and I expect you to understand. I said I'd meet you for dinner now. Isn't that good enough?
And what am I supposed to do between the time the shops close at 5 and you meet me at 7? Walk the streets?
Go into Notre Dame Cathedral and pray for my soul. I'll be here, Nicole. If you still want to have dinner, call me.
The only times Chris ever called me by my given name, Nicole, was when he was angry. That's the way it would always be with Chris and me. There would always be a book between us. A damned book. Oh, I knew I was being childish, but I was feeling neglected. I looked at the summer frock I had just finished hemming and thought of my trip to Jamaica. Maybe I would meet someone else. Someone who wouldn't put his work ahead of me. One thing I was sure of, I wasn't going to call Chris back. I'd find somebody else to go shopping and have dinner with. And if it couldn't be a man at the moment, well, there was always Aunt Emily.
I'm sorry, Nikki, but it appears I've got hold of that flu bug of yours. In fact, as soon as one of the boys come in, I'm going to send him over to borrow a heating pad from you, if you don't mind.
Oh, of course, Aunt Emily. And I hope you feel better soon.
Oh, I will, dear. You know me. I never stay down for long. And it's just as well about this afternoon. Antiques aren't really my bag. They're too old for me.
Oh, you're right, Aunt Emily. They are.
Oh, there's the door. Probably one of the boys now. Ciao, dear.
So I stayed home, watched TV, and cooked myself a lonely hamburger for dinner. Too stubborn to call Chris and apologize. Neither of the boys had showed up to borrow the heating pad for Aunt Emily, so I decided to take it over to her myself. Perhaps I could cheer her up a little, I thought. But I knew it was far more likely it would be she who cheered me up. Feeling depressed over my quarrel with Chris, I gave no thought to my walking alone to Winnicott Road. Aunt Emily's apartment building was on the corner. The main entrance was on Côte Saint-Luc, but I always used the side door on Winnicott. My aunt's apartment was on the main floor, number 3. I was about to knock when I noticed the door wasn't quite closed. The boys probably hadn't closed it on their way in. I'd tell Aunt Emily to caution them not to be so careless. I pushed the door open and walked in, calling out so that Aunt Emily wouldn't be startled. Aunt Emily? Aunt Emily? It's Nikki. The apartment was deathly quiet. Aunt Emily must be asleep, I thought. I crossed the living room, passed the door to the kitchen, and stopped dead. I saw her lying there on the cold linoleum, lying stiffly on her back with her bluish-tinged, fear-contorted face staring up at me. The realization slapped me across the face. Aunt Emily had been murdered.
Grief in the darkness, grief and despair. Nowhere, nowhere, someone to care.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Face of the Foe. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
As in every winter, Montreal is crippled by seasonal blizzards. But residents along Winnicott Road are also paralyzed by something they're not accustomed to. The threat of being raped and murdered. Tension in the vicinity is running high. Doors are locked and chained. Friends and neighbors eye one another with suspicion. For Laura Prescott, having been assaulted in the park, a new boyfriend has brought an element of security into her life. But for her roommate, Nicole Nugent, the killer, whoever he may be, has struck tragically close to home. The third murder victim is Nicole's own Aunt Emily, the picturesque, blithe spirit who was apparently loved by all. Three questions linger in the minds of all concerned. Who is this madman lurking about? Why is he doing these terrible things? And finally, and most desperately, who will be his next victim? Face of the Foe continues in a moment.
It was Monday morning, the day after Aunt Emily's murder. The sky was gray and heavy, with sweeps of angry black clouds that foretold a storm. The heavens, I thought, were protesting the slaughter of the innocent. Chris was with me, our quarrel forgotten and his book willingly set aside. Laura was there, along with Julian Brooke, his gentlemanly manner abandoned as he expressed outrage over Aunt Emily's murder, with his mouth set in a firm, hard line. And Lisa and Guy had come. Guy, for a change, silent and subdued. Lisa, beautiful and serene as ever, had taken me in her arms and rocked me gently, urging me to cry. But the tears wouldn't come. And now there was Lieutenant Philippe sitting wearily across from me, his cynical gray eyes looking bleak as death.
We know you're tired and under great strain, mademoiselle. We too are tired and under strain. There must be no more of these violent murders.
It's too late to say that now, Lieutenant. My aunt is gone.
Yes, I know how you must feel, mademoiselle, but the danger continues until the killer or killers are apprehended.
There is nothing I can tell you, Lieutenant. I can't imagine who would ever want to kill my aunt.
Your aunt had two boys staying with her. Both boys seem to have disappeared.
But she was good to them. They wouldn't have any reason to hurt her, except...
Except what, mademoiselle?
Well, one of them, Tony Bartha. My aunt was going to ask him to leave. She thought he was into the drug scene. He might have become angry and...
But then, Mademoiselle Nugent, there was someone, after all, who might have had reason to harm your aunt. Hmm?
I suppose so, Lieutenant.
It seems there's always someone.
Lieutenant, was my aunt sexually molested?
No, mademoiselle. She was spared that indignity. Although, as in the case of Elsie Grunberger, it may only have been that something frightened the killer away.
And so my Aunt Emily, who loved life and lived it with such zest, now lay stiffly in a mahogany casket between a pair of flickering tapers in a flower-banked room of Hanson's funeral parlor, her eyes sealed forever against the world of Maya. A bewildering variety of people came to pay their last respects. The stunned and frightened remaining members of St. Simon's choir, of course, and a dozen young monks from the Hare Krishna temple in saffron-colored robes with tilaks painted on their foreheads. A group from the drop-in center with Donald Hamill and Tony Bartha conspicuously absent. The supermarket clerk, the woman from the cleaning shop, the tea importer on Bloery where Aunt Emily had gone every month for her special blend of Darjeeling tea, who told me Aunt Emily had known almost as much about tea as he did, and a grizzled old shoemaker who said that Aunt Emily had been a woman after his own heart. She had always demanded that thick, stout soles be put on her shoes. None of those fashionable, skinny ones that wore out in no time. The shoes were for walking, weren't they? And she always had him put cleats on her heels so people could hear her coming. That was my Aunt Emily. I thought of her gleaming red motorcycle, stored away for the winter in her garage, and I knew what Aunt Emily would want me to do with it. If Donald Hamill ever returned, it would be his. It was the night following Aunt Emily's funeral, and Chris had suggested supper for just the two of us by the fire in his comfortable bachelor apartment.
You're not eating anything, Nikki. What are you thinking about?
Oh, I was thinking about my trip. All this has certainly taken the shine out of it.
Oh, but your Aunt Emily would be the first to urge you to go, despite everything.
I know. That's why I'm going, despite everything.
3 weeks in Jamaica is just what you need.
But it seems a bad time for me to go away and leave Laura alone in the apartment.
If you think she's nervous about it, why don't you suggest she go and stay with a friend while you're gone?
Yeah, I think I will. Well, one thing we've decided, we're having a peephole installed in our apartment door.
That's a good idea. You know, there's still that question of whether or not Kathleen Windsor and your Aunt Emily willingly admitted the murderer as someone they knew and trusted.
I'm exhausted from trying to figure out who did it and how. I'll just have to trust that Lieutenant Philippe will eventually catch the murderer.
Lieutenant Philippe looks too tired to catch anybody. But you're right, Muffet. You try to put everything out of your mind except your trip.
And giving you my answer when I get back.
You don't even have to worry about that. Considering all that's happened, I can wait a little longer for your answer.
Oh, Chris, you're so dear. I don't know why I keep putting you off.
Little Miss Muffet sat on a tuffet eating her curds and whey. Along came a spider and sat down beside her and frightened Miss Muffet away.
Is that why you've always called me Muffet?
Because you elude me. It's not just my preoccupation with writing that bothers you, Nikki. That's just part of it. You're afraid of love. You like the shallows, the quiet waters. But you're afraid of the whirlpools of love, afraid of being caught up, whirled away, lost to the maelstrom.
You're right, Chris. I am afraid.
But you have to take chances in life, Muffet. Make an act of faith and surrender yourself to the whirlpool without fear. That's what living is all about.
I knew Chris's words about life and love were true, and I was going to do a lot of thinking about them all the time I was gone. The trouble with me was I was a coward. A coward about life and love and death. Before I knew it, it was Saturday, and I was in a plane, the terror and tragedy diminishing behind me as I headed for 3 sunny weeks in Jamaica. The first thing I did on my arrival in Port Antonio was enroll in the Meet the People program at the local tourist board. I was introduced to 2 Jamaican girls my age and taken on a round of activities that left little time to think of the grim events at home. Sightseeing, swimming, water skiing, rafting down the Rio Grande, and riding the trails up into the Blue Mountains. I was so busy that my first week in the islands flew by. Montreal and murder were beginning to seem very far away. But then I received a letter from Laura.
Dear Nikki, we've been having sleet, snow, rain, and cold ever since you left.
Doesn't it make you feel smug from where you sit under the Caribbean sun? No need to worry about me. Every time I peek through our new peephole, it's into the smiling face of my handsome English escort. The more I'm with Julian Brooke, the better I like him. And I'm with him a lot. One bit of news, for whatever it's worth. Guess who I saw coming out of the parish house next to St. Simon's Church? None other than our scowling neighbor from apartment 4, T. Oliphant. But without the mysterious brown cotton under his arm for a change. What do you make of that? Love, Laura.
I wasn't sure what to make of it. Aunt Emily and the two other murder victims had been members of St. Simon's choir. Lieutenant Philippe had suggested the killer therefore might very possibly be associated with St. Simon's. And now it appeared T. Oliphant was. Yet neither Kathleen Windsor nor Aunt Emily had shown any sign of recognizing him when he passed by them in the lobby of our apartment building. Then, with a shudder, I recalled how he had looked at both of them in the same way, with that ugly sneer of his. I was glad to be so far away from Montreal at the moment, and relieved to know that Julian Brooke was looking after Laura. I was determined to enjoy my final week in Jamaica. I had splurged in a plush hotel suite, overlooking the dazzling white sandy beach and sparkling blue sea at Montego Bay. I took a leisurely breakfast on the balcony each morning, lazed on the beach until the afternoon when I went sightseeing. I thought about Chris hard at work on his book, but my mind refused to dwell on anything so serious as the question of our marriage. Then, all too soon it seemed, my vacation was over. And on my very last day in Jamaica, I received another letter from Laura.
Dear Nicky, I decided to take your advice after all and stay with a friend until you come back. There's been the bother of several anonymous phone calls. You know, the kind where you pick up the receiver and only hear someone breathing on the other end. A little frightening after all this murder business. Chris is in Toronto for a quickie conference with his publisher, so Julian and I will meet you at the airport. Nicky! Here we are.
Oh, Laura, Laura, it's so good to see you. Hello, Julian.
Welcome home, Nicole.
Nicky, what a glorious tan. Wait till Chris sees you.
Oh, I suppose you arranged this Montreal snowfall just for me,
to make you feel at home.
Laura and I had in mind taking you off to my place for a drink and a bite to eat as a bit of a homecoming celebration, if you're not too tired.
I'm not too tired. I'd love it.
Good. Then let's collect your luggage and be off.
Julian Brooke had to be a very successful furniture designer. He drove us in his sleek black sports car to an opulent glass and steel structure in Westmount, where he escorted us up to his second floor apartment, into a spacious combination living room library, elegantly furnished with sleek modular furniture and an impressive display of rare books, paintings, and sculpture. He poured us cocktails and graciously toasted my homecoming. I could see from the look he and Laura exchanged over their glasses that their relationship had been progressing well. A few moments later, a waiter appeared at the door with a catered dinner of delicious seafood.
Just one of the services of the establishment. Catered meals at the tenant's request from the penthouse restaurant.
As you can see, Julian believes in living in style.
Well, why not if you can afford it?
You're not the only world traveler, Nicky. Julian is taking off for Rome next week.
But not for a vacation, however. Purely business. I'm going to see Giorgio Bartoli, the Italian designer, about that new plant I'm opening.
Oh, it sounds exciting. Don't get him started, Nicky. His passion for innovative furniture is almost equal to his passion for boats.
And speaking of passions, I'm taking Laura to see her favorite Spanish dance company at the club midnight next Saturday evening. Do you suppose you and Chris might join us? It'll be my leave-taking party just before my plane takes off.
Well, sounds lovely to me, but I'll have to check with Chris, of course.
Julian will be going right to the airport. So if you and Chris come, I can ride home with you.
Laura, tell me about the phone calls. The ones you mentioned in your last letter.
Oh, I imagine whoever it was has become discouraged by now, since I haven't been there to pick up the phone.
I'm afraid it isn't so much those calls that caused Laura to abandon the apartment while you were away.
Then what was it? What else has happened?
I didn't want to write you about it,
while you were still on your vacation, Nicky. But now that you're back, you'll have to know.
Know what?
There's been another murder, I'm afraid.
Oh, God, that makes four. Was it another poor woman strangled?
Yes. In an apartment on Queen Mary near Godfrey. Just a block over from Winnicott Road.
Was she a member of St. Simon's Choir like the others?
I don't know. The papers didn't say. It was a very sparse account.
The police are under a tremendous amount of pressure, I suspect. Four murders, and they don't seem any closer to an answer.
Another murder. The fourth, just 2 weeks after Aunt Emily's. And it had happened in a building just a 10-minute walk away from Laura's and my apartment. The police, looking for logic, searching for clues to construct a pattern, concluded the killings were the work of a disordered mind. A mind that knew no logic, had no pattern. When Chris called on his return from Toronto, I was grateful for the sound of his voice and the feeling of his solid, reassuring presence near me again.
I hope Jamaica was more fun than Toronto.
It was beautiful, but I'm glad to be home, now that you're home, too.
Well, that makes two of us, Muffet. And you might be interested to hear that somebody else is back in Montreal, too.
Who?
Donald Hamill.
Donald? Where is he?
At the moment, bunking in with me. I found him and his guitar camped on my doorstep when I got in late last night. After that little talk he and I had at your place on his birthday, I guess he felt comfortable with me.
You're a comfortable kind of person, darling. Where has Donald been?
He hitched out of the city in a panic, but then decided to come back and try to clear things up as far as he was concerned. He's agreed to let me take him down today to give the police his story.
What is his story? And where is Tony Bartha?
Donald says he doesn't know where Tony is. When they left your aunt's house that last day, they split up. And according to Donald, that's the last time he saw Tony.
And Donald didn't ever go back to Aunt Emily's?
Yes, he did. About 6:30, according to him. He found the door open and your aunt lying dead on the kitchen floor.
Then maybe it was Tony who killed her.
It could have been. Anyway, that was Donald's first thought. He panicked and took off.
Do you think the police will believe his story?
I don't know, but I think I do.
So do I.
Well, I'll let you know what the police think over dinner tonight. How about the Carmen Espresso at 7, okay?
Oh, Nicky, was that sad your most gorgeous letter?
Oh, Chris, thank you. Now I know how much I missed you.
Well, that's what I was counting on.
Nicky, you're back.
Oh, Guy, I didn't see you come in.
Hello, Guy.
Oh, I'm glad I ran into you, too. I have something to show you. Look. It's a surprise for Lisa. Do you think she liked them?
Why, they're really beautiful earrings, Guy.
Those green stones are emeralds, in case you're wondering. I hope Lisa likes them.
How is Lisa?
More beautiful than ever. Maternity becomes her.
Lisa could never be anything but beautiful.
I know. Every time I look at her, I find it hard to believe she's my wife. Do you really think she liked the earrings?
That was Guy Saverin's big problem. He was so unsure of himself that he could never stop putting on a big show, even with his wife. Poor Lisa. I knew how she was going to feel about another of Guy's expensive gifts. Where was he getting the money to buy them? That's what I wondered. Fortunately, for the sake of my intimate reunion dinner with Chris, Guy was too eager to spring his latest surprise on Lisa to linger long at our table. Between his deadline and the extra work I found piled up at the office after my 3 weeks away, Chris and I had no other chance to be together the rest of the week. By Friday evening, I felt up to nothing more than a light dinner and early to bed. As I opened the door on the quiet apartment, I realized it was the first time I'd been home alone since I came back, since the police had issued their grisly warning. I closed the door firmly and slid the chain lock into place. As I started for the kitchen... Hello? 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 Who is this? Say something! Oh. I dropped the receiver back on the hook, drawing my hands away as though the phone were on fire. A chill shot up the length of my spine. I should have let the receiver off. But perhaps this time it was Chris or Laura calling home for some reason. Why be frightened of a silly telephone? Even if it was that creep calling back, I could just tell him to bug off. Hello? Maybe I wasn't so brave after all. I decided to leave the phone off the hook and hope that no one would try to reach me. I'd have a quick dinner and get into bed. And tomorrow I'd suggest to Laura that we have our number changed. The monotonous hum of the phone off the hook was a little unnerving, but better than that sudden shrill ring in the empty apartment. I was about to take to my bedroom and hopefully let sleep shut out all my disquieting thoughts of prowling psychopaths in the night when... It was someone at the door. But who? No one had pressed the buzzer from the lobby. If it were Laura without her key, she would call out, not frighten me with that strange soft knocking. Who is it? Why didn't they answer? I was almost afraid to look through the peephole, but it seemed whoever it was wasn't going to go away. I put my eye to the opening and looked out straight into the cold, thick glen stare of T. Oliphant.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Face of the Foe. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Beechnut Chewing Tobacco and Quaker Steak Motor Oil. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.